a tough place for the Cubs to win on the road. They're hopeful of winning the series outright tonight here on Fox Sportsnet Chicago. Two friends of yours who like to horse around, Chip Carey, Steve Stone. This is a big ball game for the Cubs. Last night it didn't go well, partner. 8-0, it was all Montreal. Yesterday was then, today is now. Hopefully the Cubs can gain control again atop the wild card pile.
Cubs and Giants are tied at the top, and now five teams in the wild card race. That means that each and every win is of critical importance. San Diego just a half game back, Houston 2.5 back, and Florida, if you'll notice, only 2 games back in the loss column, with 6 coming up against the Cubs. They have their fate in their own hands, so you've got to beat the teams you're supposed to beat. The Cubs are supposed to beat this Montreal ball club. We'll see what happens tonight.
30 games left, Stoney. It's obvious with the trends this team has established, the way they've been winning and the ways that they haven't been winning. Take a look at some of the numbers we're going to put on the screen. There are a couple of big stats that jump right out at you.
One-run games have been real tough for the Cubs, 10 under 500. Also, when they don't hit a home run, they're 11 and 27. However, the good part of this stat, when they score 4 or more, 65 and 15. So what's the key? Score 4 runs, hopefully more. Score them early because the Cubs have been falling behind recently. And tonight it's going to be Kerry Wood against Tony Armas. And so you figure the Cubs would have the advantage because of the experience of Kerry Wood.
Kerry Wood made his major league debut against these Expos April 12th, 1998. The first man he struck out was Mark Grudzielanek. Hopefully he can punch out a few more Montrealers. Kerry didn't throw the ball as well as he would have liked last time out.
And I would hope that the Cubs would be bunting against Tony Armas tonight. The reason is he was hit by a line drive, and last time out he had to leave the game early. So we'll take a look at the last time out. Tony Armas has a good arm. However, the Cubs didn't bunt at all against Roger Clemens and basically was pitching on one leg. Tonight against Tony Armas, maybe they will lay it down and put some pressure on his leg.
Hopefully the Cubs can win this series outright. We don't know where we're heading after the game. After all, I thought it was the Expos that were the vagabonds. Tonight it might be the Cubs. Hopefully we'll be flying wherever we go very happy. And being able to say Yuppie is always a good thing after a victory in Montreal. Stay tuned. It's the Cubs and the Expos from Olympic Stadium after this. Welcome back to Olympic Stadium for the wrap-up of our three-game series between the Cubs and the Expos. The Cubs took the opener by a 5-2 score behind Greg Maddux. Last night, Mark Pryor suffered his fourth defeat, so Dusty Baker and the Cubs trying to get out of town with 2 wins in 3 tries. The Cubs, 12 games over 500, line up this way with Corey Patterson leading off in center field. He'll be followed by Derek Lee and Nomar Garciaparra. Moises Alou, Sammy Sosa, and Aramis Ramirez, the middle of the batting order. Former Expo Mark Grudzielanek will hit 7th, Michael Barrett 8th, and Kerry Wood will pitch in bat 9th.
Take a look at Tony Armas. This is just his 14th start. 2 starts ago, he took a ball off his leg. Last time out, it bothered him. He only went 3 innings. So perhaps that leg is still bothering him. His fastball in the low 90s. He has more of a slider than a curveball, and he uses that along with the occasional change, but he has some control problems.
In fact, Armas in his last 5 starts has walked 18 men in 25 innings. He's also been susceptible to the long ball of late. And as we showed you in our open, when the Cubs homer, they usually have a real good game. That's what we need on getaway night tonight from Olympic Stadium. 2 balls, no strikes to Corey Patterson, looking for his first base hit of the series.
I would think with 38 walks in 59 innings, you should be patient with him.
Oh. 3 balls, no strikes.
After this hitter, we're going to show you a superstitious Tony Batista and what he does after every first hitter of the game.
Strikeout swinging?
That's what he did last night.
3 balls, 2 strikes.
Got to make Armas get the fastball down. The face-high fastball from him at 93 is pretty tough.
And he comes back from a 3-0 count. One man down here in the first inning.
Maybe he's looking for rain. He should look in Florida because it's coming.
No kidding. A lot of it. Here's Derek Lee, one for his last 15 and a 292 batting average. That was a very superstitious looking gesture by Batista, we're told.
Does it every game. It's helped him. He's having a tremendous year offensively. And when he comes to bat, we talked to him about his hitting and just exactly how he adopted that particular style, which is, by the way, the most distinctive hitting style in the major leagues.
But it works. He's hit over 20 home runs for Montreal this year. I guess the closest guy with an unorthodox stance from the other side of the plate would be Craig Counsell of Milwaukee. One ball, two strikes, the count to Derek Lee. Tony Armas skips that one up there as he tries to get his record evened up at three up and three down this year. Driven out of play, foul. And Derek Lee will stay alive here in the top half of our first inning of play.
No one in the Cubs lineup has more home runs lifetime against Tony Armas than Derek Lee.
6 for 20, a couple of home runs. They locked horns quite a bit when Derek was a member of the Florida Marlins. So now, with Derek moving to the National League Central Division, Cubs and Expos face off just 6 times in regular season play. And we'll see these folks early next week back at Wrigley Field.
You'd like to play them on the road, because when the Expos go on the road, they're 24 and 41. They've really struggled away from wherever their home happens to be.
Payoff pitch. He strikes out Derek Lee. Two hitters up, two swinging strikeouts.
Let's take a look at the Corona Expos defense and how they'll line up behind Tony Armas. It's Sledge, Chavez, and Rivera left to right with Batista, Gonzalez, Asturias, and Wilkerson. The really strong throwing Brian Schneider behind the plate and Tony Armas on the heel, two up, two strikeouts.
One of the big surprises for us coming to Montreal has not been the size of the crowd, but the number of fans wearing Boston Red Sox jerseys that have come to see the Cubs play in Montreal.
A lot of folks that live close to Montreal in the American League follow the Boston Red Sox, and they particularly idolize Nomar.
No balls and a strike. And Armas quickly ahead of him, nothing and two.
Cubs have some pretty good road batting averages the first three hitters. Patterson coming in 285, Lee 291, Garcia Parra 326 on the road. Kind of ends there though, because Alou and Sosa both hitting 249 away from the friendly confines.
One ball, two strikes. Bases clear here in the first inning for Nomar Garcia Parra, and that backs him off the plate to even the count at two. Omar has been able to play every game of this series, and it is an artificial turf surface here, but it's a springier, spongier, slower version of the turf that used to be in this ballpark. High pop, straightaway, shallow center field, and the play made by Asturias, the young second baseman, and Armas has a perfect top half of the first.
It's Toyota time with incredible Labor Day bonus values. It's the year's biggest event. You've got to act now. Get great Labor Day savings on fuel-efficient cars like the legendary Camry. Now with 0% financing up to 48 months or 1,000 customer cash. Or go for the stylish Solara, also with zero financing for 36 months. Toyota time. Selection. Value. Clearance. Now.
Circuit City's the place to save on a huge selection of the latest computers. Hurry in today and save $300 on this deluxe eMachines computer package. It's loaded with an AMD Athlon XP3000 processor, 17-inch flat-screen monitor, DVD burner, and CD-ROM drive, plus a Lexmark color printer, all for just $599.99 after mail-in rebates. now through Saturday at Circuit City.
What a wicked game to play.
Sweetie.
To make me feel this way. What a wicked thing to do. To let me dream of you. What a wicked thing to say.
I love you.
You never felt this way. What a wicked thing to do.
You're watching Chevy Baseball Wednesdays, presented by your Chicagoland and Northwest Indiana Chevy dealers.
No score as we head to the Expos half of the first inning. Kerry Wood to the mound, and this is the lineup he'll face with Brad Wilkerson leading off with 26 home runs. Andy Chavez, the center fielder, hits second. Batista third. Termell Sledge in left. Juan Rivera in right field. Former Cub Alex Gonzalez, the shortstop. Brian Schneider, Macier Turris, the second baseman, and Tony Armas hits ninth against Kerry Wood, who's 7-6 this year.
Kerry Wood looking for win number eight, and this is 17th start. The ERA just below four. Always tough to hit. Opponents hitting just 233. And he has to watch the power of Wilkerson.
He took one straight out over the boards in center field last night. And we were talking on the subway ride home, and you brought up a good point. Why is this guy hitting first with all the power he has?
Talked to the general manager, Omar Minaya, about that fact, and he says we would like to see Andy Chavez be a more accomplished leadoff hitter. He's not. Right now, Wilkerson can get on base, and Chavez is better suited for the two spot. He said also, if you make a mistake with a fastball, Wilkerson's going to hit it out of the ballpark. So he said eventually Chavez will lead off. He's just not ready yet. He doesn't see enough pitches, and Wilkerson's going to see at least four.
That one cut on late. Two balls, two strikes from Kerry Wood. Wilkerson, seven leadoff home runs this season for Montreal. Ray Durham, the only other man to hit as many in all of Major League Baseball. 2-2 count. And down on strikes goes Wilkerson. Kerry Wood punches him out in the first inning. One out.
Kerry heated it up to 97 as he threw one right by him. Good location on the inner portion and no chance at all for Wilkerson. So Woody strikes out hitter number 103, averaging over a strikeout an inning. That's really the trademark of a guy with great stuff.
Here's Andy Chavez. You want to keep him off the base paths. Very speedy base runner. And the play that wasn't made by the Cubs in the first inning last night with Chavez moving into second base turned out to be a huge play in Montreal's game two win. On a stolen base, Michael Barrett threw an absolute rocket to second base. Nomar caught the ball, put the tag on, and Chavez kicked the ball out of Garcia Parra's glove. After two successive strikeouts, Montreal erupted for three more runs for a total of four in the first.
Woody's always had problems with this team. However, this is not the same Montreal team. He's lifetime 1-3, his ERA 6.43, and this is his seventh game against them.
Two balls, two strikes. He hasn't seen these guys, though, in 2 years in an oddity.
He'll have to deal with five left-hand hitters and a bunch of guys that he probably had to be introduced to because he hasn't seen them a great deal.
2-2. That one got all the way past Barrett and hit the home plate umpire. Full count to Andy Chavez.
You have to play him pretty shallow, and you'd figure if Kerry Wood throws a fastball, he would hit it to left or left center.
He did, but too far out of play. Count will stay full, 3-2.
Without a whole lot of home runs, and this Expo team doesn't have a lot of thunder in the lineup, if Andy gets on, he's going to run. Batista, Chavez, and Wilkerson, the base stealers.
There is a shot to left, again out of play. Good battle here in the first inning. First of September. 30 games remain in the regular season for the Cubs. Three balls, two strikes. Did he go? He did go. Michael Barrett will throw him out at first base. Two strikeouts for Kerry Wood tonight.
Good pickup by Michael Barrett. This ball in the dirt. It's a Kerry Wood slider. You can't pick up the spin, even though it's well out of the zone. The hitter identifies it as a fastball. By the time he goes after it, it just disappears.
Well, when you come inside a dome as a visiting team, when you play your games outside like the Cubs do, that is a real tough disadvantage to overcome. It served the Astros well for so many years in the Astrodome.
And here the Cubs have always had problems. 13 and 28 in the last 41 games in this ballpark.
Here's Batista with that unorthodox batting stance. And he's quickly down nothing and two. Last night he became the first player since Adam Dunn to strike out five times in a game. He won't strike out this time, but he will fly out to left. Moises Alou gallops in, and Kerry Wood perfect in his first inning. No score here at Olympic Stadium.
So, you'd be able to send any package anywhere overnight. What do you think, Professor? You want in?
Son, if you can wait a year for a birthday,
I think you can wait a week for a package.
You never know what a golden opportunity will come your way. Like the Lexus Golden Opportunity Sales Event. Get your favorite Lexus vehicle at an incredible price.
And besides, people love the post office.
Yeah.
See your Chicago area Lexus dealer.
Introducing Arby's Market Fresh Low Carbies Wraps. Try the Market Fresh Turkey Ranch and Bacon or the Market Fresh Ultimate BLT. Great taste without all the carbs.
Is it true that you guys do more brake jobs than anyone else?
Yes.
And are my pads and shoes really guaranteed for as long as I own my car?
Yes.
Even if it's 20 more years?
Absolutely.
Do you ever cry at weddings?
No.
It's peak driving season. Come to Midas for great value and service every day. Lifetime guaranteed brake pads or shoes are just $89.95 installed. And they're guaranteed for as long as you own your car. For mechanics known for their work and their word.
Trust the Midas touch.
Focus and Adele, a Focus and Adele. Get the car and you'll go far with a Focus and Adele. The Dell PC is free. The Dell PC is free. The printer's fat. The monitor's flat. The Dell PC is free.
Get into any 2005 Ford Focus with 0% financing or $2,000 cash back. And get a Dell computer with a flat panel monitor and printer all free.
A Focus and a Dell!
Cubs baseball is brought to you in part by Midas. For mechanics known for their work and their word, trust the Midas touch. Corona Extra, miles away from the ordinary. And by Ford. Visit your local Ford store.
Thing about baseball is that you can do something about yesterday, tomorrow. Well, tomorrow is today for the Cubs. Yesterday, not a very good day. 8-0 Montreal, the victory. Chance for the Cubs to win the series outright tonight.
And that quote by Manny Trio, a pretty good player in his day, and now he has a video company.
That video company has a lot of computer problems, we notice, as Moises Alou goes to work in our second inning. With Sammy Sosa and Aramis Ramirez to follow.
Moises has crushed Tony Armas over the course of his career. Hitting 400. You have to figure he's going up looking first ball, fastball.
High pop, shallow left. Out goes Alex Gonzalez. He'll give way to Turmel Sledge, the best Turmel in Major League Baseball history. One up, one down.
Sometimes you can guess first ball, fastball. You can get exactly what you're guessing, and it's just not in the spot you'd like it. That ball up a little higher than Moises would have wanted, and he popped it straight up.
Yeah, you know that drives a hitter nuts when they guess right, and can't do anything with the pitch.
Get the pitch you're looking for, but if it was that easy, 3 out of 10 wouldn't be a star, and it is in this game.
Here's Sammy, a couple of RBIs in the series. He's 2 for 8. In fact, Sammy one home run shy of number 30 again. And he's hit 568 lifetime. Armas missed inside. Ball two, 2-0.
Rivera's playing him as deep as I've seen anybody play him in right field. If the ball goes over his head, it is going to go out of the ballpark. A lot of room in front of him. Florida's jumped on top of New York 2-0. The Cubs would love a little help from the Mets.
Florida nipping at our heels. Houston already won tonight. Sammy hits that hard to left. Sledge over toward the line. We'll play it on a big bounce. Third hit of the series for Sammy. And he's aboard with one out in front of Aramis Ramirez. Houston roasting hot, 1-9-3 today. Lance Berkman hit another home run.
Jeff Kent also hit a grand slam today.
And Roy Oswalt pitching himself into Cy Young consideration now. He's 16-9.
He leads the league in wins. Normally on an artificial surface, you'd expect a big hop. You're not going to get it on this surface. The ball is going to flatten out. It's very much like a natural surface, but you don't need sunlight.
High pop right side, drifting toward the line. Wilkerson and into the seats it goes. It's called field turf.
Actually and has blades, unlike the old surface.
Sure. You can't really call it carpet like you could the old AstroTurf.
Right. And it's much slower. And there is the fieldturf.com if you want to order some for your backyard or perhaps your car.
Or your head if it applies. 0-1 the count.
Oh, don't pick on Ronnie when he's not here.
That's when it's most fun. One ball, one strike.
We're going to see the coach here pretty soon.
We did find out that all the French-Canadian dogs have lodged an international protest to get Joker back to Quebec.
I think Ronnie'd like to send him at this point.
I would think so. Late swing and a miss. One ball, two strikes. And Vicky wouldn't mind sending Ronnie, I'm sure.
Well, of course, we can do this knowing full well that Ronnie is listening to the radio and watching the pictures.
Well, as long as that doesn't become a trend, it's okay with us. One ball, two strikes. Sammy at first base in a scoreless second inning game. Lance off the plate. You remember Tony Armas' dad, I'll bet.
I do, and he was a pretty good hitter for Oakland. In fact, we got in a beanball war with those gentlemen, and he was a guy that I was chosen to throw at.
Oh, great.
Yeah, he ran faster than I did. It wasn't a pretty good thing.
Two balls, two strikes. Missed the corner. And it's full at 3-2. Ramos doesn't strike out much. Will nope. Dusty send Sosa here?
Well, if you throw him, if you send him, and Ramos doesn't make contact, he's going to throw him out. But Aramis is one of the better power hitting guys for making contact, so I think he's going.
He is. Grounded to the big hole, right side, perfectly executed. Sosa will be on his way to third base. That's why you can run with Ramirez. He hit a tough pitch to the open spot in the diamond. Wasn't hit hard, but found a hole in the Cubs in business, first and third.
For a young guy, and for a guy that can hit the ball out of the ballpark, Aramis makes pretty steady contact. And runners at the corners, only one out as the Cubs threaten to break through.
Ramirez, 27 home runs, only 54 strikeouts, and 440 at bats now this year. That's old school power hitting. And here's Mark Grudzielanek. He's 1-for-5 in the series. Cubs would like to jump in front. Yes. He went around, nothing in 1-year count.
Well, you're looking at the first man that Kerry Wood faced in his career. And Mark Grudzielanek at that point wore the uniform of the same Montreal Expos. And by the way, that resulted in a strikeout.
High and tight. He evens up the count. One ball, one strike. In game one of the series, Cubs did a real good job of making contact in contact situations. This is one of those, preferably in the air, off the bat of Grudzielanek.
Bear in mind, Rivera has a great arm in right field.
12 assists has he for Montreal, and that's over the outside corner. One ball, two strikes.
And you've got Barrett in the on-deck circle. He's hitting close to 300. So it's going to be a difficult decision if Grudzielanek does hit a fly ball to right. And with that in mind, Rivera is, as we speak, windmilling his right arm to get it loose.
Look out into the seats.
That one really rifled back. Unfortunately, there are so many empty seats that that one hit one of them. It's a small but spunky crowd.
Exactly right. 8,100 two nights ago, 7,100 last night. Another 1-2. Grounded back to Armas. He'll try to start a double play. Alex turns it, and the inning is over. No runs, two hits. Mark made contact, but couldn't get the ball airborne, and we're still scoreless. Our Buick opinion poll. Neither Steve nor I are responsible for the content of this particular question.
That's a disclaimer. We would like to get that out front.
Exactly. What's your favorite Canadian export?
There you go.
Exactly right. Termel Sledge leads off the second inning against Kerry Wood tonight.
We saw this guy at first in the opening game. We saw him in left field last night. He made just a spectacular catch, and it might have turned the game around. He kept the Cubs off the scoreboard in the fifth inning. Oh.
Sledge has had a good series. 4-for-9 with a home run. For a little guy, he's got a good bat. He hit a long home run here in game. Was it yesterday or game one?
Game one.
Game one of the series.
Tom McCraw would like to see him use left and left center a little more. When he gets pull conscious is when he says he has some problems. But if he realizes that he should be an alley-to-alley hitter, he's going to be able to pull the breaking ball and hammer the fastball the opposite way. Ideally, that's the way Tom McCraw, the hitting coach, thinks he should hit.
2-2. These Expos in this park, despite being 20 games under 500 overall, are just 3 under here at home. And late July through the month of August, they've played some tough teams that have more than held their own, Steve.
Well, Omar Minaya said that as soon as they got the Puerto Rico part of their schedule out of the equation, second half of the year at home, they've actually battled very good teams to a standstill, and we've seen it here with the Cubs.
2-2. And he went around, couldn't stop himself. Third Wood strikeout against Florida, Houston, Dodgers, Cardinals, Giants, Padres. Montreal's 15-12. Cubs would take that right now if they played those teams in September.
Well, you can see they're scoring more runs, the batting average way up, and that's despite a depleted team. Jose Vidro out for the year. When you draw Levan Hernandez in a matchup, then you really have problems with these guys. He is the one real star in that starting rotation.
Line drive right center field by Juan Rivera. Softly hit, but it finds a hole. He's going to try to take two, and he's out by plenty.
Well, that's an absolutely awful base running play. Only in that he's got the play right in front of him. Sammy got to the ball quickly. And Sammy really didn't even have to get a whole lot on the throw. The ball beat him by plenty. And a good assist by Sosa. He gets to it, and I think he's amazed that Rivera's running. They got him, as they say, from here to Gary, Indiana.
Well, Rivera thought that Nomar missed the tag. And he very well may have. But he came off the back there, so at the end of the play, the correct call was the result for the second out. And here's Alex.
This is where he's dangerous. You've fallen behind 2-0. If you don't throw the breaking ball, Alex, as we know, can really hurt you. Last night, Mark Pryor fell behind, and on a 2-0 fastball, he rifled a double.
Blazing fastball. Two balls and a strike.
Gary's got pretty good stuff tonight. That slider is crackling, and the fastball right around 96, 97, so he feels pretty good.
That one exploded out and away. 2-2 now.
Alex could spend the rest of his life and not hit that one.
And
I don't think anybody
could. He'd have plenty of company, sure. That's about as late as you could swing and stay alive, but do what he did.
Well, one more slider, the at-bat's over, and it'll be back up to the bottom part of the order with Michael Barrett. Kerry's got a particularly good slider tonight.
Right down central. Four strikeouts for Kerry Wood through two innings of work. Still no score. Cubs convention takes place at the Hilton Chicago the weekend of January 21st, 2nd, and 3rd, 2005. Reserve your rooms now for the Cubs convention weekend. Call the Hilton Chicago, 312-922-4400. Weekend passes, Steve, for $50 each. They'll go on sale Monday, November 8th, beginning at 10 a.m. If you need more information, call 773-404-CUBS or log on to Cubs.com.
Every time I think of that Cub convention, I can't help but think of John McDonough. We had a chance to talk with him today. John is feeling a little under the weather, but he says all his problems are behind him. So we were very happy about that. And he's certainly rooting for a big Cub win tonight.
Toto rooting. High fly ball center field. That's playable for Chavez. Former Expo Michael Barrett flies out to open up our third inning of play.
Well, you figure that Michael, who was a battering mate of Tony Armas, should know what he was throwing. He guessed a fastball. He got it, but hit it straight up in the air. So the Cubs had an opportunity last inning with a couple of base hits by Sosa and Ramirez, only to see them turned away by a good defensive play by Armas.
Kerry Wood's a good hitter. Let's see if he can help himself here. How about the Yankees last night? In the grand history of the New York franchise, never before have the Yankees suffered a defeat like the one they took last night. Cleveland beat them 22-0.
You could call that an ignominious defeat. And the boss was right in attendance at Yankee Stadium.
Well, that loss for New York and a Boston win cut the Yankee lead to 3.5 in the East. And guess what? Boston's winning again tonight over Anaheim. Yankees are losing 1-0 to a very good hitting Cleveland ball club tonight. And that's the question mark. Will the Yankees starting pitching be good enough the final month to hold off Boston? And if they do, will they be good enough to win the World Series? Right now, you'd have to say the answer to that is no. Down the right field line, that's playable and caught by Rivera. Two men down. Curt Schilling, by the way, picked up his 17th win for the Red Sox. Oakland has opened up a 3-game lead. Surprise, surprise, the A's are at it again in the second half. They're 13-1 the last 2 weeks.
Great pitching steps up late. Let's see if Corey Patterson might be thinking about laying one down. Put the pressure on Armas's leg, which hasn't been particularly good.
Corey struck out. He was ahead in the count 3-0. He does bunt, but it's right back to the pitcher. And he throws a seed to first. Wow, Wilkerson lucky to get the webbing up in time. Three up, three down, last of the third.
Well, if Corey Patterson bunts this any place but right back at Tony Armas, he probably has a base hit. The throw beats him, and then Brad Wilkerson is so happy with this, he flips the baseball to a young man who loses most of his popcorn but has a souvenir if he can grab it away from that guy who caught it.
And that kid was brought up right. He's not eating the popcorn off the top of the dugout either. And it's still sitting there.
He's leaving it for Yuppie.
Ryan Schneider, what a year he's having with the glove. Not a bad year at the plate either. 12 homers, 42 knocked in.
The Expos think eventually he's going to hit for pretty consistent power. When talking with Omar Amanaya, he said he loves the way he throws. He says he feels we haven't seen his ceiling yet as far as the bat is concerned.
That one spun out of Kerry's hand. One ball, two strikes. Well, he's left-handed, throws brilliantly, hits for power. I mean,
he's only 27 years old, so he should be coming into his best year.
That's the other part. Left-hand hitting catchers who can do the things Schneider does defensively are very valuable major league commodities.
You can stay around forever. We've seen that with guys like Brett Main, Paul Bacco, another guy who stayed around a long time, a good defensive catcher. You can pick up a lot of years in the major leagues if you can do that.
High pop right side. Derek Lee will gallop down. That ball
hit the speaker.
It did hit a speaker, and it was played nicely by Grudzielanek. No problems. That retires Schneider. One away.
That ball hit as high as you could possibly hit it.
Here's Macier as Turris, his first major league home run in the series. The younger brother of Cesar as Turris for the Dodgers. And already they've begun to debate here in Montreal as to who's going to turn out to be the better player and the better fielder.
Well, they think it's the one they have as opposed to the one the Dodgers have simply because they have him. But his brother is hitting close to 300. And his brother's made great strides with the bat and a tremendous defensive shortstop. Macier, bear in mind, just 19 years old, but the advantage he has as a switch hitter is he'll never see that breaking ball break away from him.
Think eventually he could be a leadoff candidate for this Montreal team?
Right now they prefer Chavez. But don't forget, his tourist is playing second. He's not going to play there because they got Vidro signed for four more years. Now, they know that Alex is a free agent. Probably they're not going to be able to afford him. So his tourist will probably be the starting shortstop next year.
2-2 count. Bases clear, one out. And Kerry Wood has five strikeouts in the game. He's really blowing smoke here in Montreal. Here's Armas, still looking for his first base hit.
You can tell the days when Kerry feels real good because you saw this extra pop on the fastball in the first inning. When he's throwing 97 in the first inning, you know that he's going to keep that for a while, and his slider tonight is pretty close to unhittable.
Armas backing away, wanted no part of that 96 mile an hour pitch. Strike one to the Expo pitcher.
He hasn't had what you'd term a great year with the bat. They've been able to hold his big bat hitless in 13 previous at bats.
Fouled away. Wood has a second strike on his opponent, Tony Armas.
Tony out of Venezuela, and his father wisely taught his son how to pitch, but left out the hitting instructions.
Kerry Wood has six strikeouts in the game's first three innings. No score at Olympic Stadium.
The spirit of American style. And by Ricoh. How well do you print, copy, scan, fax? How well do you share?
Aflac! Scoreless game as we go to the top of our fourth inning. Let's look at tonight's Aflac trivia question. Which Expos player hit the last homer at Old Jerry Park and the first home run at Olympic Stadium? We'll have the answer for you when the Expos come up in our fourth.
Well, two guys jump out at you. Rusty Staub would be one.
Yep.
And he'd also be the other one.
Rusty Staub and Rusty Staub Jr.
LeGrand Arjet.
Here's Derek Lee. That's outside ball one. Derek struck out his first time. Well, there was an historic event that took place at Jerry Park 33 years ago today. Of course, everybody knows Jackie Robinson, the first man to break baseball's color barrier in baseball history. In 1971, the Pittsburgh Pirates did something that had never been done before. They fielded the first all-black lineup in baseball history. With Al Oliver, Rennie Stennett, Jackie Hernandez, Dave Cash, Willie Stargell, Roberto Clemente, Doc Ellis, and Manny Sanguian. Gene Kleins, the Cubs' first base coach, was the center fielder that day here in Montreal. And old Jerry Park, I never got to see a game played in the original home of the Montreal Expos, but everybody who did see games or play games there thought it was great.
And if you were a first baseman for the first three innings, you couldn't see because that sun was right in your face. So you had to allow the base runners pretty much to run at will.
There was a swimming pool out there somewhere, right?
In right field.
Two balls, two strikes. And very friendly ushers, I understand.
Usherettes, mostly, yes. Cubs would like to draw a couple of walks from Armas. So far, his control's been pretty good, but that could go at any moment. Like right there.
There is the first walk. And Omar Garcia-Parra will come up for the second time. Cubs had two men on in the second inning. Nicely executed hit and run. Put Cub runners first and third, but a double play erased that threat. After we've only seen three hits so far in the first three innings tonight. Nomar, as you know, a notorious first or second ball hitter. Big lead by Lee. Not going, and the pitch popped up. Back over by the Cub dugout. Schneider is there, and Batista is there. It's the third baseman. Four out, number one.
Easier play for the third baseman. The catcher will have that ball actually rotating away from him, but Batista came in, called him off, and made the play. Now, Derek Lee's getting a pretty good lead. And he's swiped eight bases this year, so he's number two on this club in that department. And if you forget about him, I think that's what Schneider's going out there to talk to Tony Armas about. He allowed that guy to get almost a walking lead, and he will steal.
What's the measure of a real good lead on the artificial surface?
1 foot on the carpet. If you can get 1 foot on the carpet and still be able to get back with a good pickoff move, usually have a good lead. That time Armas didn't really look at Derek Lee, and he got a walking lead.
Alou guessed right, just didn't have the right bat angle. Popped out to left. His first trip up against Armas. Let's see what he can do here in the fourth inning. He takes a strike this time, nothing and one the count.
One of the ways that any pitcher will try to combat a base stealer is vary his times to home plate. If a base runner can time you, and usually with a right-hand pitcher, you look at the front shoulder or back leg to see which moves. If either of them move, the pitcher has to come home.
One strike pitch. Fly ball hammered center field. Chavez going back. And he will make the grab shy of the track. Derek Lee went three-fourths of the way to second base. And he's back at first after a well-struck ball is caught in center field. Two down.
Deepest part of the ballpark, and Chavez with good speed had plenty of time to run back under it. It's a fastball on the inner half. Andy Chavez off with the crack of the bat. He runs it down.
That'll bring up Sammy. He singled his first time up.
Sammy's swinging the bat a whole lot better these days, getting more plate coverage and getting pretty aggressive.
That's in for a strike. Subtle adjustment for Sosa in the batter's box. We talked about that with him on our trip up to Montreal.
Yeah, and if the Cubs are going to close with a rush, and you would expect with their schedule that they would do that, they've got to have Sammy hitting the ball out of the ballpark.
He's one away from 30 again for the Cubs this season. And that one out of play, foul.
A lot of folks like to look at last year and say that it was a disappointing year for Sammy Sosa. He hit 40 home runs.
It was disappointing by his standards.
Yeah, but when you look at all the baseball and you look at a guy that hit 40 home runs, you'd say, that's a pretty decent year. He's not most likely going to get to 40 this year, but it depends on the wind at Wrigley Field. If we catch some hot weather, the wind blowing out, he could get to it.
0-2, Lee at first, scoreless game, fourth inning. It's subtly too, Steve. We've noticed Sammy's been able to lay off that breaking pitch that's been outside, and he's done a better job of laying off that fastball up and away.
I think as you start seeing the ball better, you start laying off pitches. What he has to lay off of the Armas slider.
Let's see if he can do it. Instead to first. Lead off walk in the fourth. With two outs, Derek Lee still standing there. Did lay off, two balls, two strikes.
And one of the adjustments that Armas has made, you notice now he's holding the ball a little bit longer, not letting Derek Lee time him.
The 2-2 pitch now. Good at bat continues for Sammy. Atlanta 3, Philly 1, that game in the second inning of play. Jarrett Wright trying to go to 14-6 for the Braves, who've won 8 of their last 9.
One of the things the Cubs have going for them, Tony Armas, and this is his 14th start, has averaged under 5 innings per start. So he's not used to going deep into the game.
Lined, and Alex makes the play at short. Hard hit ball, but Gonzalez spears it, and the Cubs are out of luck in our fourth inning. Do this to the opponents. This time, he robs his former teammate, Sammy Sosa, with a good catch at short.
It's a sinking line drive, and it was tough to keep off the turf. He was able to do that. And Kerry Wood has had to be at his best because Tony Armas is at his best. So he'll move back to the top. He's faced the minimum of 9-3. You have to be careful of the first ball fastball to Wilkerson because a lot like Garcia Parra, he likes it early and he can put a charge into it.
Upstairs for a ball. One ball, no strikes. For Wilkerson, he's been a real pest. 88 walks, 91 runs scored for this Montreal team. And you can see why Steve and I were talking earlier tonight about someday this guy moving down in the order to drive in more men.
Right now they just don't have anybody that'll consistently take some pitches and work the count deep.
This one popped up. Will it stay in play for Barrett or Aramis Ramirez? Michael Barrett near the Cubs on deck circle has room. An easy out retires a dangerous hitter as we revisit our Aflac trivia question. Can you name the man who hit the last home run at Jerry Park and the first here at Olympic Stadium?
Ellis Valentine.
He was part of that great Montreal outfield of Warren Cromartie and Andre Dawson.
Two-thirds of them could really throw.
Here's Chavez. He was thrown out after a check swing strikeout by Michael Barrett. Carey's given up just one hit, a single to Rivera in the second. He tried to stretch it into a double and was thrown out very easily. That's in for a strike. 2-1 your count. We'll see these Expos early next week back in Chicago. As that one misses high for a ball three. Still don't know when we're going to see the Marlins. Quite obviously there are far greater issues than a three-game series down at Pro Player Stadium. The hurricane is headed for that part of the country. And certainly folks are watching on the satellite down there. Our thoughts and prayers are with everybody in the state of Florida. This will be the second big hurricane coming their way in 3 weeks. And the governor down there has declared a state of emergency as they're trying to make sure everybody's safe and sound. So we're not sure when we'll join you next. Line drive left field. Moises comes over toward the line. Very nice play. And Chavez is out number two.
Figure on a fastball that Endy's going to hit it that way. So Moises shading him toward the line took away a potential double. Chavez hits it hard. Moises right there to make the play. It's an inside out swing. And Kerry Wood sailing right along. There's only been three hits in the game.
Here's Batista. He popped to left his first time up.
He told me in the Caribbean series he was 0 for 25 and said, I got to change my stance. So he devised this one, hit the ball hard the next two times up. And he's hit that way ever since.
Popped up to the right side this time. Mark Grudzielanek is there. Wood has an easy fourth. The scoreless duel continues between Kerry Wood and Tony Armas in Montreal.
I'm David Kaplan in the Fox Sportsnet studios with a Pontiac in-game update. Kobe Bryant's legal drama may be over. Various sources reporting today that the prosecution will drop all charges with prejudice, which means they can never bring the case to trial again. The civil suit will proceed. Guys, take it away.
And into the fifth inning we will go. We still have no score. Chip Carey, Steve Stone as we enter our Toyota Fan of the Game inning. Today's contestant, Joy Swoboda of McHenry, Illinois. If the Cubs can push across a run here, Joy will win a Fox Sports Net Toyota prize package, which includes a hat and a t-shirt. And Aramis Ramirez drives it out of play for strike one here in the Cub fifth. He has one of the two Cub safeties tonight. The other belongs to Sammy Sosa.
He got a hittable fastball on the first pitch and fouled it straight back. They used a hit and run with him last time. This time he's probably thinking about hitting it out of the ballpark.
Pop to the right side. Can anybody get to this ball? Well, they're a long run. Can't get there in time. And it's nothing in two.
When you're playing deep in right field, and even though that one was hit way up there, too far to go for Rivera. Mark Grudzielanek in the on-deck circle. He had an interesting quote in the newspaper. We'll read it to you at the resolution of this at-bat.
Nothing in two now. Way outside to Aramis.
For the most part, this is very much a veteran team for the Cubs. They've been through this many times, and they know they've got to put the hammer down with 30 games left. That wild card is there for the taking. Houston's just getting hot, but bear in mind they've got six with the Cardinals. San Diego has six with the Cardinals. Cardinals are a team right now that nobody wants to face because they win every day.
San Diego's in Busch Stadium later on. Here's the 2-2. And it's back out of play. San Diego is going to send Adam Eaton to the mound against Chris Carpenter. The Cardinals have activated Rick Ankiel. He is in St. Louis and is eligible to pitch tonight, if need be, for the Cardinals. Two balls, two strikes. Lined over third, and Aramis Ramirez is 2 for 2. Good start for Joy Swoboda and the Cubs in our Toyota Fan of the Game inning.
Mark Grudzielanek, after the game last night, said that we have all the talent we need right here, especially since the Garcia Parra trade. That's awesome. But the difference is how we handle the pressure, and obviously in the last few months we haven't been handling it all that well. However, the good news, guys are starting to understand that and relax. And if that's the case, with the schedule they have, the Cubs should be winning the wild card and go to the postseason.
Mark hit into a double play his first time up, and that's in for a strike. It is a very different experience, I'm sure, for a lot of these players, certainly for us, for our fans, for our organization, It is a unique experience when you are expected to win. And after a division championship last year and coming within five outs of going to the World Series, the perception of this Cub franchise was dramatically changed for the better. Hard hit ball left field, two straight hits in the fifth inning.
And something to bear in mind also against Armas, we told you that he's averaged under five innings per start. And although he sought his way through the lineup the first time and a half, this guy's not going to make it all that deep in the game. So the Cubs taking advantage of it here in the fifth inning. And this is the inning you'd think they would break through.
Now Batista had to talk to Armas about how the Expos plan to play Barrett defensively here.
Well, I wouldn't think that he would be bunting with Kerry Wood up next. Look at the ERA. You see how it swells in the middle three innings. And, of course, he's not around for the last three, so it's a real non-factor.
Four Cub hits tonight, just one for the Expos. The way Kerry's throwing, you figure you get him one, that might be enough tonight.
Mayfi Perez has joined the team. Always helps to add a gold glover. Switch hitter. Jim Henry got him as a free agent.
Ground ball toward Batista. He'll go to second quickly. One on to first, double play. If that ball had been hit a little closer to the bag, they had a chance for three on that play.
Great turn by Asturias. This is a natural shortstop. It's, bear in mind, not an easy transition because you have the double play in back of you as a second baseman as opposed to always in front of you as a shortstop. But he gets rid of the ball quickly, and because he's a natural shortstop, he's got a rocket for an arm. So after two hits, back-to-back singles for the second time in the game, now they're one out away from getting out of the inning, but a long way from being out of trouble because Kerry Wood can swing the bat. He hit the ball hard the first time up in the third inning. And there's a look at Ben Grieve, who will give them another left-handed bat off the bench.
You saw briefly Ben talking to our fine traveling secretary, Jimmy Bank.
Jimmy Bank, of course, wanted to know who he was. Always wanted to know your traveling party.
Jimmy probably wanted to know if Ben was renting the house next door to his in Milwaukee. Who's making all that noise over there? One ball, no strikes. Ball two to Kerry Wood.
I don't think he asked Kerry Wood to take the pitch here because you know you're going to get a fastball. And he could put himself up 1-0.
Line drive right field. Rivera is there. And that'll retire the side. Two hits lead off the fifth. A double play and a line out, though, spoils the Cub party here at Olympic Stadium.
Back-to-back hits twice. They haven't been able to cash them in yet. So Kerry has to continue to batten down the hatches. He's got to go right through the heart of an order that's depleted but tough in their home park.
Will this be the last time the Cubs play these guys in this ballpark?
No.
You think we'll be back here next year?
I do. Now, I don't know if that's going to happen. Don't forget I picked the South in the Civil War, but I think they'll be right back here in this ballpark next year.
Well, it's a beautiful city, and we certainly hope that the Expo situation is resolved to everyone's satisfaction, not only quickly, but judiciously, because you don't want to move them someplace else and have an even bigger mess than you have now.
I certainly enjoy French food on occasion. Didn't have a chance to get quite as much of it as I wanted to. Never been to the restaurant that the guys keep talking about here, the Chez Paris. So if we come back next year, I want to try that one.
Termell Sledge is the hitter. It's nothing and two to the Montreal left fielder. And Sledge down for the second straight time, almost the exact same at bat.
You're not going to hit that slider. If Kerry Wood has his best, it looks like a fastball till the last instant and then just dives out of sight. If he gets ahead of you, you could go up there without a bat and do as well. Only hope against Woody is get something early in the count, because if he gets you in a slider situation tonight, it's just been overwhelming.
Here's Rivera. Rivera has the only Expo hit.
Seven strikeouts, no walks tonight.
And when he's got what he's got on that mound, it's a long night for the opposition's offense.
Well, you could tell real early that he felt good. We talked about it. The slider was crackling, and it stayed exactly there. And the bullpen up and going for the Hall of Famer Frank Robinson.
One ball, two strikes. 0-4-0 for the Cubs. 0-1-0 for the Expos. And Sonny Kim is up for the Expos.
Well, I think Frank knows that after shoulder surgery and the fact that Armas being hit with a line drive and perhaps not yet with the endurance saw him weakening last inning. He's gotten him through five with no score.
Line toward right. Sammy near the line is able to track that down. Nine straight Expos have been retired. Two outs for Alex Gonzalez. Braves add to their lead. It's 5-2 in Philadelphia tonight. Florida still leads the Mets 3-1. Ishmael Valdez, by the way, pitching for Florida, going for his 100th career win tonight. Tom Glavine is pitching for the Mets.
Tom Glavine has the best home ERA in the major leagues. It's not helping him very much tonight. And the Cubs then will miss Ishmael Valdez, something they didn't want to do.
The rotation for both the Cubs and Marlins, Zambrano and A.J. Burnett. Clement and Dontrell Willis, Greg Maddux, and Josh Beckett. That, of course, predicated on when we'll get down to South Florida. That's it for Montreal. Through five, a pitcher's duel continues. No score.
You for around $139 a month after GMAC bonus. Residency restrictions apply. Call for details. The performance of the year. The ride of a lifetime. Now playing at your Chicagoland, Northwest Indiana Pontiac dealer.
Cubs fans are invited to the Magical Gatherings Vacation brought to you by AAA Travel. Join Billy Williams, Aramis Ramirez, Lee Smith, Jody Davis, Jim Hendry, LaToya Hawkins, and Gary Matthews December 2nd through December 6th in Orlando. You'll get to enjoy all the holiday magic in Walt Disney World, including a welcome party, private events exclusive to Cub fans, and a whole lot more. Call 1-866-4-AAA-CUBS for more information.
It's never really a good sign if you're the starting pitcher and they're warming somebody up in the bullpen when you go out there. The Cubs are hoping to take advantage of what should be a tiring Armas.
But he's showing no signs of weariness. He's walked only one man. He struck out the first two he faced. Since that point, he's scattered just four hits and gotten the ground ball double plays when he's needed the most. So Armas throwing real well, as is Kerry Wood tonight. One ball, two strikes, the count to leadoff man Corey Patterson.
Corey did a nice job of laying off that tantalizing fastball just off the outside corner.
Hard hit ball and foul. Moment of indecision there by James Hoy. But no argument from the Cubs. Patterson will stay alive.
It's always somewhat surprising you throw three fastballs that a guy doesn't really get a good look at. And then throw that one slider. And Corey came an eyelash from doubling or perhaps tripling down the line. You'd expect to see a fastball away. We'll look in at Schneider. There's the fastball. And he wants it away.
And that's where he put it. Corey down on strikes now for the second time tonight. He's hitless so far on the road trip. One away for Derek Lee. He has struck out and walked tonight. One of the real good stories and good guys in baseball has taken place tonight. Andres Galarraga activated by the Anaheim Angels.
It's really nice. It's his second battle back from cancer.
He's 43 years of age. And
he also is sneaking up on 400 home runs, I think. I think he just needs a few, but I'm not sure.
Well, they're in Boston tonight. Anaheim down just a run as that one smoked right center field. What a play by Chavez in center.
Well, you could see him closing on it. The only question you'd ask was, could he get there in time? He wouldn't have been able to standing up. He was shading him toward right center, and he's able to make the play on a flat-out dive. What a play by Chavez. This isn't one of those catches where you catch it and then dive. He left his feet and made the play. That's a triple taken away from Derek Lee, and that could turn out to be a very important play in this game.
So a marvelous effort in center field. Here's Nomar. He takes the ball high. You can see why they like Chavez here in Montreal. Speed never slumps on the carpet. It pays a big dividend here in the sixth inning. Play by Nomar, two balls and a strike. Count evens up now at 2-2 in the Expos sixth. Schneider is Turris and the pitcher spot coming up against Kerry Wood. Fly ball softly hit shallow left. On comes Turmel's sledge. He's under it and has it. And it's a three up, three down, sixth inning.
Joe Period. Weeknights on Fox Sports Net.
Now that is a good looking pair of haircuts. That's one Dave Otto ought to employ. There's still time. He'll join us with David Kaplan back in Chicago for our Cubs post-game show.
Well, it is official. We are going back to Chicago this evening. After that, we really don't know what's going to happen. We do know that instead of Fort Lauderdale, it will be Chicago tonight. So for all the families watching, you will get your Cub family member home this evening. It'll be late, but it'll be home. 58-37 here tonight.
More World Cup hockey in Montreal tonight. As Schneider takes outside, even the count, one ball, one strike.
And with Armas up third, you'd figure after six, Frank Robinson would figure a job well done. And he'd take him out.
Lined into center field. Patterson, long run, still going. Got over his head. Schneider on his way to second base. There is a leadoff double for the Expos catcher, who's hit safely in 13 of 14 games now, and that could pose sixth inning trouble.
Well, we told you that he had some power. At first, Corey Patterson thought he was going to make this play. It's a fastball down, and Schneider hits it awfully hard. You see Corey at first coasting and then realizing this ball was just taking off over his head.
So here's his tourist.
Well, the job for his tourist, one way or the other, if he has to bunt it over, he's got to move Schneider to third with nobody out. And they're in at the corners expecting the bunt.
And he takes high. Barrett's snap throw back behind Schneider, a play that worked very effectively for Montreal earlier in the series. Keeps Schneider close at second.
You got a Henry Mateo in the on deck circle. It's Majewski and Kim in the bullpen. It's former major league pitcher Claude Ramon, former broadcaster. He's in the bullpen for the Expos. Nice fellow is Claude.
There's the bunt. And is Torres is out by a step at first.
Great play by Kerry Wood, because he came up ready to fire to third. But the ball was bunted hard, and Kerry Wood did a pirouette and got a very fast man at first base. Watch Woody. He barehands it. He's going to fire to third. He has a presence of mind to stop and fire to first. That's just an outstanding effort by Kerry Wood. And he makes sure that Snyder couldn't advance. It wasn't a good bunt, but it was a great play.
So it will bring up Mateo in the sixth. Mateo swings the bat from both sides of the plate here.
Talk about how big that play was. Now you can play the infield back. If that sacrifice was successful, if he had pushed it to third, you'd have to bring the entire infield in. It would be a lot easier and at bat for Mateo.
Six pinch hits for Mateo and 23 at bats. And he looks at strike one call. Vidro hurt, Nick Johnson hurt for this Montreal team. Two very big losses for them. Ground ball right side, fumble for a moment, and all hands are safe. And there's the importance of the Kerry Wood play, and at least for the moment, keeps a run from scoring.
Well, if the bunt would have been successful, and that probably is a base hit, we'll have to wait for the scoring. It is a hit. That's a tough play. But if the infield is in, that's through the right side for the run. As it is, it's runners at the corners, and only one out. Mateo gets a pinch hit. It's a slider. He hits it in the hole. I don't think Kerry Wood would have beaten him to first base anyway. So that's why it was a base hit, even though Mark Grudzielanek bobbled it for the moment, but he kept the ball in the infield.
Schneider at third, Mateo at first. Wilkerson the hitter. He has struck out and popped out. You don't want to trail these guys, at least the way they're pitching out of that pen right now. In 27 innings, the Expo bullpen has an earned run average of one.
Wilkerson's grounded into just six double plays this year in 462 at bats.
One ball, no strikes. Evens the count.
Woody could use a strikeout, and Wilkerson does it a bunch. He's fanned 121 times. 122 could be one of the biggest plays in the game.
And he's one strike away from having that happen.
Well, if you throw the slider in the dirt, Michael Barrett has got to do anything he can to block it. Kerry has four wild pitches. It's a good spot to go to Wilkerson. That slider low and in for Wood has been devastating tonight.
Strikeout and none bigger than that one. First and third, two aways now, two away now.
He gets it exactly where he wants it. And down goes Wilkerson. Big strikeout and out. Moises Alou has got to be careful. On a fastball, Chavez isn't going to be able to pull it. He'll pull the breaking ball, but he'll hit the fastball to left or left center.
He struck out and has line to left. Good breaking ball has Chavez down a strike. Luis Ayala now joins Majewski in the Expo bullpen. Kim sits down. At the belt, taken for a called second strike. Kerry trying to pitch her out, a leadoff double. Keep it scoreless for the middle of the Cub order in the seventh.
A live run with Mateo here. Put the pressure on Barrett.
Oh, they got it. Kerry Wood picks him off.
And they were running, and it's a great pickoff move by Kerry Wood.
Mateo picked off. That ends the sixth. What a job by Kerry Wood to keep this game scoreless. With scoreless innings in Montreal, Tony Armas' evening is complete. And Gary Majeski takes over for Montreal. He's been part of a very solid bullpen under the tutelage of pitching coach Randy St. Clair of late.
He came over from the Chicago White Sox along with John Roush. That was in exchange for Carl Everett and a few bucks. There you look at some pretty impressive numbers, although it's been a very small sampling in the major leagues. He was used as a closer at AAA. He had 15 saves. The Cubs are going to try to break through after Kerry Wood with some great defense, a wonderful pickoff move, and he got out of a tough jam in the sixth.
Seventh no decision for Armas in his last eight starts for Montreal tonight. Six scoreless innings, three hits, make that four hits, a walk, and three strikeouts for the Expo right-hander. And that one right back up the middle. Alou aboard with a leadoff single. Cubs have had some chances to put a couple of runs on the board here tonight. Here's another shot in the seventh.
This game becomes of critical importance when you look up at the board. You see the Mets leading Florida 4-3, that game in the top of the fifth. And you also realize that tied with San Francisco. San Francisco in a homestand they should take advantage of, with Colorado and the Diamondbacks in a six-game homestand.
Colorado really scuffling. They've lost eight in a row and started a 12-game road trip 0-7. Tonight they'll send Jamie right to the mound against Kirk Reeder. We talked about it last night as well, about the possibility of a Jeremy Burnett and Sean Estes deal to the Giants. That did not happen. And published reports out west say that none is expected to be made between those two teams. But that could change. Barry Bonds, by the way, did not homer. He does have 696 of those. And he's moving upwards with another Hall of Famer. He's three hits away from our own Billy Williams. On the all-time hit chart, Billy with 2,711.
Sammy has a 3-0 green light. Let's see if he can take advantage of it.
Three balls and a strike.
Cubs want to break through before they get to the Ayala Cordero portion of this bullpen. So this is a good time to do it.
Jammed him and it's hit foul down the left field line and into the seats.
Last night in a similar situation, a 3-2 count, they sent Moises Alou. Sammy Sosa hit the ball hard, but right at Rivera. Let's see tonight if they send him again.
Cubs did break out a hit and run earlier tonight. It worked perfectly with Aramis Ramirez. Let's see what happens on this 3-2 pitch. He's not going, and the pitch cut on and missed. High fastball, one out.
Take a look at the forward game summary. Cubs' middle of the lineup has been pretty good. Kerry Wood has been absolutely magnificent. His control has been perfect. And Tony Armas threw a brilliant game. So far, not much to choose from as the Cubs have out hit him 5-3. But all goose eggs on the board.
Ramirez 2-for-2. Just eight hits through six innings and one third tonight by both teams combined.
This team is 14 over with Ramirez in the starting lineup and two under with Ramirez out of the starting lineup. Gives you some sort of an idea about just what this young man means to this team.
Here comes the 1-1 pitch. Hey, nice catch. Barehanded grab off to our right. Another chance for the fans. This time, however,
that one not quite as successful.
Exactly right. Played it on a hop. One ball, two strikes.
Tough to get that third strike past Aramis.
54 times, that's it.
Well, that's the reason why he's hitting about 316 or so. You don't find many young third basemen combine the arm strength, the power, and just the ability to hit that Ramirez possesses.
1-2. Fights it off again. .325 down the lines here, .375 to the alleys, .123 to straightaway center. Two balls, two strikes.
Jeske wanted that one. He thought he had shaved off the outside corner with that slider, and Rapuano had other ideas, and Ramirez stays alive.
Good lead by Alou at first. The pitch. He just will not give up an at bat here in the seventh.
Well, Moises has got to break up too if there's a ground ball. He's got to do his best because we know Ramirez isn't running 100%. It keeps the inning alive if there is a ground ball.
The stretch now. And there's a fly ball hit hard to left, but Turmel Sledge is there. Back to first will go Alou.
Majeski wanted that sinker inside. And he got it in far enough that Ramos couldn't get the good part of the bat on the ball.
So Mark Grudzielanek will greet him now.
See where he's set up? That sinker goes inside. Ramos tries to bring his hands in. You want to get the sweet part of the bat on it. He just didn't get it and lifted it to left field.
Mark has a base hit tonight. A live fastball misses outside. A lot of Cub fans wonder how Joe Borowski's doing down in Iowa. Joe had a tough night of it last night. A run on three hits in the eighth inning. Iowa lost to Memphis 4-3.
But last time out, he threw very well. So what it is a product of him trying to get the arm strength back, and you can almost look on a graph, Chip, and it's up and it's down, and you have a real bad outing, then you have a good one. Eventually you start having real good outings, but it takes a while when you've been out as long as Joe has to get that shoulder strength back.
Richard Lewis, formerly of the West Tennessee team, now playing at AAA Iowa, was named the Southern League's 2004 most valuable player. In 99 games, he hit .329 and drove in 59 runs. Remember, Lewis came over from the Braves organization with Andy Pratt, Juan Cruz deal. The Cubs feel like he has a shot to compete for a roster spot in spring training next year, perhaps.
The Expos did have one call-up and likely another call-up, and the Cubs will be familiar with him. There's a chance Brendan Harris will come up. Not determined yet. But you'd figure when the Cubs see this team in Chicago, they might see their former teammate, the guy who spent a brief time here, Brendan Harris. He was the key to that deal that sent Cabrera to Boston and allowed Garcia Parra to come to Chicago.
Yeah, we saw Brendan briefly with the Cubs, and Omar Minaya, in our chat with him yesterday, said he wasn't making any deals unless he could get Harris included.
He thinks he's going to be an everyday major league player. Moises has to get a decent lead because on a double, he's got to score.
Two balls, two strikes. And that'll reach the seats again. Cardinals have jumped in front of San Diego 3-0.
Well, there's a surprise.
Cardinals went 26-5 in July, 26-7 in August.
Winners of four in a row, and they're 43 over .500.
They're beating Adam Eaton tonight. Snap throw to first is in time.
Boy, that's just an awful piece of base running.
Those woes continue for the Cubs. That's five times Mo's been doubled off or picked off this year. And we're in the stretch time in Montreal, scoreless. Mansion win card, 100 random winners. We'll get a Mitchell & Ness Cooperstown Authentic Collection 1990 Andre Dawson home jersey. There's no purchase necessary. Fans are encouraged to hold onto those cards for a second chance drawing. And for complete rules, visit Cubs.com.
Well, Kerry Wood's been just unbelievable as he's limited the Expos to three hits in a nothing-to-nothing game. And he's had to be that good.
He struck out eight. He has yet to walk a man. He has allowed three hits.
But looking on the bright side, Grudzielanek will get an opportunity to lead off next inning.
And you never know what can happen. 0-1 the count. Here's upstairs to Chavez, who has struck out and lined out tonight.
That's the best way to neutralize a running game, is make sure that Batista, Chavez, and Wilkerson don't get on. And they're the base runners.
Crowded toward the hole. That's tough play for Nomar. Strong arm, and he got his man. What a play.
That one could turn out to be a game saver. Nomar with a very strong arm. He got a left-hand speed burner in the hole at shortstop. Andy Chavez with great speed. Nomar off-balance throw. Gets a whole lot on it and gets it there. An eyelash ahead of Chavez. Well, this is just a great effort by Garcia Parra. And he was out. Good call.
Super play. Retires Chavez. Here's Batista. He's 0 for 2. Popped up right side. Well, when you get pitching like the Cubs are getting from Kerry tonight, you do not want to waste this effort.
And I think you got to be careful with Tony Batista for the simple reason he's gone up there with just one idea right now. It's a nothing to nothing game. He's their home run hitter and he's thinking about hitting the ball out of the ballpark. It's best to try to keep the slider away from him because he's real strong.
Line center field, that's playable. Two men out.
And you're right, Kerry Wood just has had overwhelming stuff all night long. But that defensive play by Garcia Parra, when you consider that it keeps Chavez off the base and he's likely to really test the combination of Wood and Barrett if he gets on, not many shortstops in this league could make that throw from that position and throw a speedy man out.
If Kerry gets to two strikes on terminal sledge, think you'll see a slider?
Yeah, I would think so. He hasn't really dealt with it very well in two at bats. Kerry's still rushing it up there.
Termel, look for breaking ball.
Well, there's no reason to look for it. You can't hit it. You want to hit the fastball in there. He looks like he could have played in the Little League World Series this year that Curacao won.
And if he strikes him out again, he'll be just as blue. Base is clear, two outs, seventh inning. Off Barrett's glove. Two balls, two strikes.
I don't think I'd mess around with the fastball at all to this guy because you can end the at bat with that slider down and in. Woody started out with two strikeouts, serving notice to this Expo team that he was going to be awfully tough to hit, and it stayed that way throughout the game.
The 2-2. He runs it full now. Three balls, two strikes.
Bullpen up once again for the Expos.
I believe that's Ayala again.
The Cub bullpen hasn't even adjusted their hats. That's how dominant Kerry Wood has been.
Fastball. So with two outs, Sledge is aboard with a single to center, and that'll bring up Rivera.
He's hit the ball pretty well twice. This has been the one right-hander in the lineup that's had good at-bats against Kerry. Low fastball, Sledge hits it well. He's had a pretty good series.
That is his fifth hit in 12 at-bats against the Cubs. And here's Rivera, 28 hits last month for Montreal. He's got one here on September 1st as well.
He's a product of the Javier Vasquez deal. He's one of the guys that they were really high on. I think they've got a pretty good one.
Well, he throws just like Vladimir. We saw that.
And I would think after the last move that Kerry made to pick Mateo off in the sixth, Sledge wouldn't be very adventuresome on the base paths. He doesn't have great speed. He's only 2 of 4 in stolen bases.
Patterson playing around toward right with Rivera in the batter's box. Lots of open pasture in left center field. That's upstairs. Ball two, 2-0.
Last time up, he had a real good swing at a fastball, and he drove it to the right side. You figure out a fastball, that's where it's going.
That one gets away, and Sledge in scoring position now with a 3-0 count.
I think personally you got to put him on and take your chances with Alex. Flip a coin. We don't know what the official score is going to call it. Probably a wild pitch. It is.
So a 3-0 count to Rivera. Scoreless game.
Kerry leaning back into a 98-mile-an-hour fastball.
He's been 94.
I just worry about Rivera. I'd have to throw him a breaking ball with first base open. Let's see what Woody decides.
I agree with you. 3-1. They did miss way outside. He didn't offer at it. Two are on with two out. And Alex Gonzalez, the hitter. Again, what does give you pause? If Alex is thinking fastball and it's over the outer half, he's shown he can hit the ball fair down the right field line in this series.
Well, he did it when Mark Pryor fell behind him, but Kerry Wood has had his number through two at bats. Nothing gives a hitter more pleasure than to torment the team that traded you away. And that's what's happened with Alex, who's going to be a free agent at the end of this season. So we wish him well after this season.
Two on, two out. Nasty pitch at the knees, strike one. Blistering fastball, 0-2.
Woody got out of a nasty jam last inning, trying to do it again here in the seventh.
And he does. We're through seven in Montreal. Still no score.
Hyundai's winning.
Brought to you in part by Cadillac. Bold vehicles defying convention. Robert Morris, real college for the real world. And by Nissan, who invites you to shift the way you move through the world.
Top eight, still no score, just 9 hits combined tonight. And the Cubs' lower third is coming up. Grudzielanek, Barrett, and Kerry Wood, nobody up in the Cub bullpen.
Louie Ayala comes into this one, and he's been a busy man. This is his 70th appearance, and the ERA is sparkling. Cubs are going to have to produce a run from the bottom part of the order. Kerry Wood has been absolutely brilliant. They're looking up on that board, and the Mets still have the lead on the Florida Marlins, team that the Cubs will play next. Remember, San Francisco plays later against Colorado. And St. Louis has jumped on top of San Diego. So there will be ground to be gained in the wild card if the Cubs can just get at least one.
Hard hit ball. Batista knocks it down, picks it up, throws low to first, and a nice pickup by Wilkerson.
He doesn't make that play unless it's late in a close game and you're playing the line. That one was ticketed for a double. Tony Batista, who hasn't had the greatest year defensively, is over near the line. He's able to knock it down. This is a real good play. This ball is just scalded. And Wilkerson picks it out of the dirt.
So Mark Grudzielanek robbed by Batista. Here's Barrett. Michael 0 for 2 tonight. Strike one call.
Ayala's only walked 10 in 78 innings, so he's had very good control.
Ayala out of the Mexican leagues. Jumps ahead, nothing in two to Michael Barrett. The back end of their bullpen's in pretty good shape with this guy and with Cordero, as you mentioned. Claudio Vargas pitched also in game one.
Last night they just got an outstanding effort from LeVon Hernandez, a guy who's leading the National League in complete games. He could have completed the game last night. He had an 8-0 lead, but he went 8 and turned it over to Tucker. And that saved their bullpen, and these guys should be fairly well rested.
How about Hernandez at the plate? He's trying to win the Silver Slugger Award for pitchers in the National League.
He's a terrific hitter.
He had a couple of hits at RBI last night. And Michael Barrett's battled back to a 2-2 count.
Upfield playing straight away. Michael Barrett has enough power to take it out of this spacious ballpark.
Back our way and out of play. 2-2.
The Cubs cannot afford to come up north of the border. Even though this park has tormented them over the years and lose 2 of 3 to a very undermanned but very determined Expo team. I mean, this team is still playing hard. They just have had a whole lot of injuries.
Tomooka's got a broken finger. Tomooka's got a broken radius. Zach Day's got a broken finger. We talked about Nick Johnson, broke a cheekbone. Beltran shut down for the rest of the year with tendonitis, and Vidro going to have knee surgery. They're all big parts of this Montreal team. That ball ate him alive. Grounded to the left side. Batista off balance. Gets his man by a step.
Batista's had a good night. That looked like it had a chance to be a base hit, but when you get jammed, you get turned around in the batter's box, you can't get out as quickly as you'd like. It's just a product of where the pitch was. And so you lose a step, and Batista cut the ball off and made the play at first. Pretty good effort, and he gets Michael by a good full step.
Kerry Wood will hit for himself. Why not, the way he's pitching tonight?
I don't want to take the ball out of his hands right now. He has thrown great.
No balls and a strike from Ayala. Looking ahead to the Montreal portion of the eighth inning. They'll have the lower portion of the order coming up.
And for the Cubs, this was very important outing for Kerry Wood for a couple of reasons. You've got the day off tomorrow. By Kerry going deep into this game, it gives that bullpen a couple of days to recharge the batteries, because he had a huge series coming up home and home with the Florida Marlins. And those six could determine the outcome of the wild card, because the Cubs have 9 games left with teams over 500. Just 9 of the 30 games they have left. And this schedule ought to produce a wild card. I think the Cub players know that. Mark Grudzielanek as much said it in the newspapers. They feel that the wild card is theirs. nobody's going to hand it to them, quite obviously. They have to go take it. But the schedule works out very much to their favor.
Two balls, two strikes. And we go to the bottom of the eighth inning. It ain't nothing, nothing time.
In-game update, the wild card race continues to heat up. Take a look at some scores of interest. Houston wins their sixth straight. They beat up on the Reds. Florida leads the Mets in the middle stages. And Atlanta putting Philadelphia out of their misery 5-2 in the fifth. Back to Montreal. Here's Chip and the Stone Pony.
All right, Camper, thank you very much. That's Jarrett Wright going for Atlanta. What a turnaround year he's had for the Braves. Dodgers will be in Arizona later on tonight. Steve Finley facing Arizona, and Randy Johnson last night hit a home run, drove in four for the Dodgers.
Dodgers are playing their best baseball at, for them, the best time of the year, and they've got Adrian Beltre making a run at the MVP.
And they're getting Hideo Nomo back tonight. He's facing Brandon Webb.
I'm not sure if that's necessarily a good thing. He was throwing the ball very poorly before he went on the DL. So Brian Schneider to lead off. He does have some power, and the Cubs saw it when he doubled leading off the sixth inning.
Now you don't see too many batted balls get over the head of Corey Patterson unless they're over the fence.
Well, that's when Kerry Wood was at his best. He pitched around a leadoff double and then got out of a two men on, two out jam last inning.
One ball, one strike.
I think it's Cordero warming up in the bullpen.
Kerry has been extremely economical tonight. That's the 103rd pitch for him in a game that's seen him strike out nine opponents.
1-1. And for Kerry, he served notice early that tonight he would have enchanted stuff. There's Chad Cordero, their number one draft choice last year.
That one beaten into the turf foul. One ball, two strikes to Schneider.
It's not often you take your number one draft choice and he makes the major leagues in the same year and turns into a closer. That's what's happened to Cordero.
Oh. The closest might be Wagner, the kid for Cincinnati, who hasn't closed.
Except
Danny Graves there.
Yeah, he's not going to close, I don't think, anytime soon. And they'd love to keep him healthy.
That has been a problem. Same for Graves, and Kerry Wood has double-digit strikeouts tonight in Montreal. One away for his Asturias.
There's either a hard slider or breaking ball. It's out away from Schneider, and he can't catch up to it.
It was his Asturias' bunt that Kerry Wood fielded, faked to third, held Schneider at second, and on a 360 spin threw a strike to first to get his Asturias by a quarter step. That turned out to be a huge play for Mateo Fala with a squibbing infield hit to the right side that would have played it the first run. Pitcher due next for the Expos with the bases empty and one out.
Well, they've got pinch hitter up in the on deck circle. Probably was the call up because he's not on the roster that we have.
Pascucci.
That's the call up.
0-2. Won't be made.
By the way, he does have tremendous power. I don't know if he's going to make any contact, but when he comes to hit, he can hit it a long way.
Hard hit ball. That's inside the first base bag. Fair and into the corner. His Asturias can really run. Sammy's got to dig it out of the corner. His Asturias around second on his way to third with a one-out triple.
He's 19 years old, and he's already proving to be a most difficult man to defend. He took it right down the line. Derek Lee never thinking that he could pull Kerry Wood in this situation. Woody throws him a slider. This one stayed up a little longer than he'd like. Kerry hasn't made too many bad pitches tonight. And with it down the line, as Torres just outruns it. Nothing really Sammy can do. He's got to wait for the ball to come off the corner. And as Torres in easily at third base, that's the go-ahead run. Now with the infield in at all four positions, Kerry Wood desperately needs a strikeout.
First major league home run for his Torres in this series. That's his first triple. And now he stands 90 feet away for Pascucci here in the Expos 8.
This is not America's Pascucci, is it?
I'm not quite sure. Valentino Pascucci.
He is, to this point, the lone call-up for the Expos.
And he's a gigantic man, 6'6", 235 pounds.
Well, in a situation where Frank Robinson needs contact, he's put up a guy that can hit it a long way, but I'm sure with that swing, probably strikes out a great deal.
132 times last year, but he also walked 101 times. He lays off there. Pascucci, originally a 10th round pick of the Brewers 8 years ago. Instead, he went to the University of Oklahoma to study marketing.
Still a lot of pressure on Michael Barrett.
1-1 count, infield in. Strike over the inside corner.
Barrett wanted it inside. Now you have him set up for the slider.
Wilkerson waits next. Grounded toward third, and
I think it's a fair ball.
It is a foul ball, late call by the home plate umpire.
Well, he's saying it. I thought Ramirez might have touched it. Ed Rapuano said, well, what did he say? Let's see.
It's on the line there. But as it got toward the third base back, nobody touched it, and it hit Torres in the shoulder, and the shoulder apparently in foul territory. Watch.
Hit him off the left shoulder. They wave it foul.
That's twice in this series.
It's unbelievable.
Never seen it before.
You don't see it, and you see it twice. The last time we saw it, it went fair for the Cubs.
It hit off Bacco, turned into a hit and a run. And the ground ball again, same spot, nearly the same play. Another chance for Rapuano to yell foul.
Well, this is a weird game. Those are two unbelievable plays. This one, however, was clearly foul. I thought that Ramirez might have touched that ball in fair territory. Not this one, the one before. That one's in foul territory. Woody still needs that strikeout. He's still looking for it with the slider. This is a huge game for the Cubs. Kerry Wood has been brilliant. So this is the biggest situation with only one out in the eighth inning.
1-2 count. He got it. 11 strikeouts and none bigger. Everybody can back up to normal depth now for Wilkerson's up.
High heat and a late swing. Mike Remlinger now throwing in the bullpen.
Be careful of Wilkerson though. He's 0 for 3. He has struck out twice tonight.
Hasn't had the ball out of the infield to this point.
A one out triple has his Torres at third. Wood checks him, winds and fires. You're seeing why, should the Cubs get into the postseason, why no one wants to face this Cub team. If Kerry Wood can get on a roll like this, he will be awfully tough in October. Ground ball right side. Takes a funny spinning hop. Carry to the bag and another masterful job in the eighth inning. He pitches around a one-out triple, and we go to the ninth inning still without a score. That is Bob Albrecht. Tonight's director, Dave Turner. Our associate producer, Joe Corneo. Moheen Ramsey's our production manager. Josh Wines, our executive producer. And our vice president of programming and production is Don Graham. A scoreless game through eight at the Big O. How appropriately named is this ballpark tonight? Nothing, nothing, and Cordero is on.
Well, it's time to paste one on Chad Cordero, who's 4-3 on for the 59th time. He's the closer, but nothing to close tonight. The Cubs in desperate search of a run. And they've got the top of the batting order. If they don't score, it'll probably be Remlinger. If they do, it will be Hawkins. And Corey Patterson to lead it off.
And bad news in New York. Marlins have taken a 5-4 lead over New York. So here we go, ninth inning. Patterson 0 for 3, 0 for 11 in the series. He did try to bunt back in the third inning, but bunted it right back to Tony Armas.
And the one soft spot for Cordero, he's given up 8 home runs in 66 innings. For a closer, that's a pretty high total.
There's another bunt try. This one back over the screen and out of play. Strike one to Corey Patterson.
Corey, I believe, has 11 or 12 bunt hits this year. They're hugging both lines to take away the double. Alex Gonzalez is playing up the middle. A lot of room on the left side.
It's 11 bunt hits. Takes a shot toward left and fouls it back. 0-2 your count. Much tougher count to bunt with now, with nobody on or out in the ninth. Schneider well outside the catcher's box that time.
Yeah, he set up well outside. Even though he hit his glove, it was a good 6 inches off the plate. Cordero last year, an ERA in the ones in just 12 appearances.
So from the outside to the inside, and he's evened up the count. Two balls, two strikes. Third time tonight, Corey has gone down swinging. One away. You can see why you don't want to be in the Montreal bullpen late. They don't give up anything. In fact, they've given up 3 runs now in 29 and a third innings.
Fastball right on the outside corner.
Derek Lee, the hitter. He's walked in 3 plate appearances.
And although we haven't seen it tonight, the real advantage the Cubs have over this team is tremendous power. And they've got home run hitters up and down this lineup. It's just that the pitching for the Expos tonight has been a little too tough. In fact, the last 2 nights, you would say it's been tough because the Cubs haven't scored.
So 17. Actually, a 22 inning scoreless drought ongoing in Montreal, going back to game one.
They scored a single run in the 4th inning of the opener. And that was the last run they scored.
Two balls and a strike.
The Rally Caps. Or just an ill-fitting hat.
Or they're going to go to the Shedd Aquarium tomorrow and check out the sharks.
Well, any way to get a run, the Cubs need most likely just one. The Expos will have 2-3-4 in their half of the ninth. Would be nice if it was LaToya trying to nail down his 21st save.
Popped up right side and out of play.
If you missed it, the Cubs have announced that instead of going to South Florida because of the hurricane, they will be heading back to Chicago after the game tonight. After that, it's yet to be determined exactly what's going to happen. They do know that the man you're looking at has been brilliant in blanking the Expos through eight.
2-2. Right down the middle, and two strikeouts in the top of the ninth.
Cordero just threads a needle. That ball drifts back and has the entire plate. Derek just got outguessed. Not much you can say.
That'll bring up Nomar. He has hit the ball in the air three times this evening.
Well, he'll be trying to jump on the first ball fastball and hit it out.
Let's see what Cordero has in mind. Line drive, left field, base hit. So Nomar is 1-for-4. And it'll bring up Moises Alou. He extended his hitting streak to 5 games with a 7th inning single. Alas, he was picked off to end that frame with Mark Grudzielanek in the batter's box.
Well, there's nothing any good hitter wants to do after he makes a base running blunder than hit the ball out of the ballpark or double in what proves to be the winning run. So this is when Moises is his most dangerous. And a lot like Garcia Perry, he'll be guessing first ball fastball.
He got it, hit it right back where it came from. Nomar around second, has to stop there. So two are on, two are out, and it'll bring up Sammy Sosa.
Both Ramirez and Alou with a couple hits tonight. That sends Schneider out. For the first time, Cordero will have a base runner at second. They'll change the signs. Moises gets that first ball fastball and takes it right back up the middle. So the Cubs with an opportunity, a runner in scoring position, something they haven't had very often. But they've got it here in the ninth as Hawkins and Remlinger continue to throw in the pen. Remember, if you're going to run on Rivera, you better have a good jump.
12 assists and only 65 starts in the outfield for the Expos. One ball, no strikes. Right through there, evens it up. Cardinals still lead the Padres 3-0 in inning number 5. And St. Louis.
Cordero heats him upstairs. That's where he wants to go to Sammy. Sammy lays off. One base hit most likely wins this game. Come on, Sammy. Everybody wants to go back to Chicago as quickly as possible. Did a good job of fighting off a high fastball there. And a great secondary lead by Garcia Pera. Nobody's paying any attention to him. That could really pay great dividends because on a base hit, he'll be tough to throw out. But remember, you got Ramirez in the on-deck circle.
Protecting again is Sammy, and that one off the facing of the upper deck here.
I don't think Schneider liked the location of the last pitch. He's gone out there to talk with Cordero. Now, Batista's coming over because he wants to know where he's going to work Sammy. If he's going to try to get the ball inside, Batista will go to the line. St. Clair is coming out. He just wants to make sure everybody's on the right page here.
Randy St. Clair, a pitching coach you don't hear an awful lot said of. But people up here in Montreal think he's one of the best in baseball.
Well, that's high praise. I know they really like him. And you're not going to hear a whole lot about most of the folks up here. They don't get a lot of national TV exposure. But we'll take a look at where Bautista sets up. Got to get some sort of an idea about how they're going to work Sosa. He's not right on top of the line. Figure they're going high and away with this.
Foul ball as he went to an E.
What Sammy wants to get is one slider that hangs out over the plate.
Called third strike.
Cordero missed his spot by a foot and a half and got the call.
Unbelievable. Bottom nine, scoreless.
Rarely will you see a catcher have to move the glove that far and still get the benefit of the call. Sammy can't believe the call by Ed Rapuano. He said it was a strike. That time, Cordero missing his spot by 18 inches or so turned into gold, and Remlinger will now come in. Unfortunately, Kerry Wood can't get the win in this. Folks, he was just absolutely overpowering for eight innings. And Mike Remlinger on for the 37th time. He's got to go right through the heart of the order.
11 strikeouts, one walk for Kerry Wood tonight in eight scoreless innings. So it's Remlinger against Chavez, Batista, and Termell Sledge here. Montreal's pen gets busy. They've got a lefty up. And a ball low and away as Chavez takes the punt.
One of the reasons why it's a nothing-nothing game is the base runners for the Expos have been kept off base. It's Joe Horgan throwing in the pen. If you can just get by the Ayala Cordero duo, you're going to be in pretty good shape.
Chavez, as you see, is without a hit. Nomar Garcia Parra made a game-saving play, perhaps to rob him of a hit leading off the seventh. And there's another punt try and out of play foul. For strike two. Chavez hit it deep in the hole. Nomar running toward the third base line. Backhand stab. Fired a bullet to first. And got Chavez by a quarter step. And the importance of that play. Sledge singled. Rivera walked in that frame. Almost hit him on the way by. Two and two.
Well, Troy Hawkins continues to throw in the bullpen. You would think he would be ready for the Rivera-Gonzalez eventuality if it does come up.
Don't want to walk this guy. 3-2. He's got 23 steals this year.
Derek Lee is very close to the line and deep at first.
Bouncing ball towards second. One man down. Here's another dangerous man, Batista. 23 jacks for him. The outside corner. What's so amazing about Batista's game last night, not only was it five strikeouts, but he only struck out 55 times all year coming in.
Well, that was what amazing to me, because I looked at the number, and this is a guy that, even though he does have a lot of power, doesn't strike out much. Last night he just swung at the invisible ball all night. But he's still one guy in this lineup on a daily basis that can hit it a long way out.
High fly ball got under it. Left center field. Corey Patterson camping out. And here is Termell Sledge. Sledge got a fastball to hit last time against Kerry Wood, and he picked up a base hit. The three-game crowd total here in Montreal, 21,121 fans. The Expos are trying to send 5,800 of them home happy tonight.
Well, you'd love to see Frank Robinson decide that if the Cubs do indeed get this out, then he only wants to see Cordero pitch one inning. I'd like to see anybody else in there but him.
Little flare, shallow left. Moises is coming on, and Mike Remlinger has a perfect ninth inning. Free baseball north of the border. No score after nine. Spectacular defensive efforts from both clubs, and we're nothing after nine.
And this is probably the biggest play of the night for the Cubs. Couldn't believe that Nomar Garciaparra could make that play against Chavez from the hole, and as it turned out, as the inning unfolded, that was the key play. So Cordero does indeed stay in the game. Frank Robinson trying to buy one more inning for his lineup. But the Cubs have Ramirez, Grudzielanek, and Barrett here in the top of the 10th.
And 23 innings without a run for the Cubs here north of the border. And let's see if Ramirez can solve that. He's 2-for-3 in the game. Something in the eye for a moment. Now he's set to go.
I hope it's a home run.
Blown away, ball one. Padres are on the board in the sixth inning. It's 3-1 St. Louis now. Pirates in Milwaukee tied at one in the fifth up at Miller Park. Popped up out of play right side.
Imagine the Cardinals going out of their way to do the Cubs a favor. They took one from San Diego last night. They're on top a little later in that game tonight.
I think that Cardinal team is playing with such great composure. They don't care who they match up with in the postseason. I mean, you talk about a supremely confident team, and justifiably so. That's that St. Louis club right now.
Well, normally when you lead the league in offense and you lead the league in pitching, you're probably going to do okay. And then you're second in the league in defense. That usually leads to baseball's best record, and that's what they have.
Popped up. No chance for Schneider.
Well, let's take a look at the teams in contention for postseason play and look at the statistics in pitching. St. Louis, Atlanta, Los Angeles, Chicago, San Diego, and Florida. 1-6, the top pitching clubs, 1-6, all in the hunt for the postseason.
The one exception, the Astros. Where are they?
The Astros are behind New York. So the top eight, seven of the top eight pitching clubs are in contention for the postseason.
One ball, two strikes. Again, the count to Ramirez. Tough man to strike out. Broken bat. And Aramis left with the handle.
And Batista didn't want to field the bat, so Wendell Kim will do that for him. Ramirez got jammed with that one, but was able to stay alive. Plenty more bats where that one came from. I'd like to take the ball in that same hole between short and third.
He does, but hits it in the air. And it's going to drop in front of Termell Sledge.
I can't believe that he didn't come get that ball. That ball hung up there for a while and looked to me like he was going to make the play easily. He pulled up, and that's the go-ahead run at first.
Three-hit game for Ramirez. We'll take that. Here's Grudzielanek. Good start.
And Termell pulled up a long time before this one dropped.
Now the two steps, and he's got a real good shot at that. Well, we'll take the break, no problem.
And a pinch runner now. three hits for Ramirez. He'll leave the game, and Tom Goodwin comes in.
I don't know if you want a straight steal against Schneider. He's thrown out 50% of would-be base stealers this year. Let's see what Dusty has in mind. He did break out a hit and run earlier tonight.
Well, they've done that a couple times in the series. They did it with Greg Maddux and tonight with Ramirez. It worked both times. But the ability to use a pinch hitter in this inning and the expanded rosters, you might think about a bunt here with Grudzielanek.
He is bunting, and he pushes it toward first. And the tag applied cleanly by Wilkerson. Sacrifice, three unassisted. Brings up Michael Barrett with Goodwin in scoring position and one man out. Michael 0 for 3 tonight.
Got Todd Walker in the on deck circle.
One ball, no strikes.
Remember, closers aren't used to going a couple of innings, especially young closers.
Through there. 2-1. AL action. White Sox trailing Oakland 3-1. As we told you earlier, Oakland trying to win their 14th game in their last 15 played tonight. Baltimore beating Tampa Bay 6-0. Yankees 4, Cleveland 1. That one in the seventh. Fly ball right field. Chasing Rivera back. Still going back. He's got it. What a catch. Goodwin could not get back to tag.
Well, that's a pretty good base running play on the part of Goodwin in that you think this has got a chance to go over his head. It's not near as important to get the third with two outs as it is with one. Rivera makes a good play, and Goodwin, thinking about it for a second, thought for a moment it was going to get over his head. And then you don't want to run on the arm of Rivera. So it still now does take a base hit.
Now Todd Walker will pinch hit for Mike Remlinger here. Mike, a perfect bottom of the ninth inning.
Good inning of work for him out of the pen, and they're going to walk Walker.
And Frank Robinson's going to pitch to Patterson here, who up until this series had been one of the Cubs' hottest hitters, but he has gone 0 for Montreal to this point.
Well, he has an advantage. And that is he had never seen Cordero before the ninth inning. Now he did strike him out, but at least he's seen the way the fastball moves. He's seen the velocity. And seeing a pitcher for the second time in two innings has got to be an advantage.
So here's Corey 0 for 4 tonight. And the Cubs break through tonight in the 10th. Strike one.
Goodwin with great speed on a base hit. It's going to be very difficult to throw him out at the plate, and you've got to test any of the outfielders unless it's a one-hop rocket to left.
He's got him way behind now, nothing and two. Same type pitch.
This is shaping up to be the same at bat. When he did this last time, he went 0-1, 0-2, missed 6 inches outside, and came back right on the outside corner. Corey's looking away. It's a good ball to punch to left field.
Ordero sets, goes up and away. Patterson took it. It's even now at 2-2. This is the pitch you figure he wants action on. Schneider wants to talk it over. Boston beating Anaheim again 12-5. Boston led that one big. Anaheim came back to tie at 5-5, but that explosive Red Sox offense has scored 7 unanswered runs. Well, those boys can hit. And Patterson is down on strikes for the 4th time. 24 straight innings without a run for the Cubs. Martinez takes over at third base for the Cubs. He will bat in Aramis Ramirez's spot in the order. And it's game number 64 for LaToya Hawkins.
He's got 20 saves and 26 opportunities. ERA a fine 2.76. And he's got to face 5-6-7. Rivera, Gonzalez, and then the catcher, Brian Schneider.
Rivera has been on base twice tonight. And he will be the first man out of the chute for Frank Robinson here.
And Kerry Wood did a great job in the 7th inning. He pitched around Rivera and fanned Gonzalez to get out of a jam. Kerry didn't get in too many of them tonight, but when he did, he pitched himself out. He had just magnificent stuff.
Rivera with 7 home runs and a .287 batting average will start off the Expos 10th. And Hawkins blisters the outside corner. Strike one, your count. Claudio Vargas up in the Expo pen. Should we go to the 11th? Cubs are hoping that'll be the case. Same pitch, same call. 0-2 count.
Alex Gonzalez, one of only 3 of the Expos that's seen LaToya Hawkins. And he's hitting .333 against him. And he is in the on-deck circle.
Out of play from Juan Rivera. Atlanta will be in next to play these Expos here. We will await notification as to when we can head down to Florida. Again, thoughts and prayers to folks in South and Central Florida as Hurricane Francis is bearing down on the Sunshine State again. 0-2 count.
Cubs are 3-2 in extra innings on the road. That's a pretty good number. Ramon Martinez hugging the line at third. Likewise, Lee at first.
Hawkins throws it right past Rivera. One up, one down. Twelve Expos have been struck out in tonight's game. Alex has gone down twice.
Fastballs middle into Alex in baseball games. The Cubs saw that a lot.
I was going to say late, this guy's awfully dangerous. High and away, ball one. Popped him up. Center of the diamond. Derek Lee comes charging in. Barrett is there, too, to help out. And Derek makes short work of Alex. And here's the catcher, Brian Schneider. Remember, he's hit 12 home runs this year.
Good pitches by LaTroy. There were two sliders on the first two pitches, and he kept them in the infield.
Be wary of Schneider. You've got his tourists waiting next. Tim up left side. Long run for Alou. Out goes Nomar as well. It'll be Garcia Parra and Hawkins. A perfect bottom of the 10th. Still no score. Here we go to the 11th inning. Lee, Garcia Parra, and Alou are coming up.
Claudio Vargas comes in the game. He's on for the 39th time. The ERA up over 5. Walks have been a problem, and the Cubs saw him in the series. They saw him in the opener. He went 2 perfect innings. And here he is in the 11th, and it's the heart of the order. Lee, Garcia Parra, and Alou to face Claudio Vargas.
Vargas went 2 in game 1, and he will go to work scoreless. Derek Lee, 0-for-3 with a walk tonight. Looking for his second hit in his last 19 at-bats for the Cubs. Have gone 24 straight without a run. Popped up right side. Here's Turris and Rivera. It'll be the right fielder Juan Rivera in fair territory. One man down.
Garcia Parra Alou had back-to-back singles in the 9th against Cordero, who pitched a couple of innings. He gave up 3 hits. But in striking out 4, he was able to get through. We've gone a long way scoreless in this one north of the border.
Driven foul. I don't know if the Expos are ever going to have a big payroll in the next couple of years, but with the young pitching they've been able to put together in this bullpen, that is going to be a wonderful advantage for them to have in National League play. We haven't even seen Francis Beltran. We know all about him. He's been shut down for the rest of this year.
Well, the Cubs can look up at the board and see that Florida defeated the New York Mets 5-4.
So as if we needed any more urgency for this ball game tonight, that adds a little more.
Well, Florida came in just 2 losses back of the Cubs, 3 games overall. But the loss column really is a column that counts. You can't get those back.
And the Marlins indeed are streaking. Florida's won 9 of their last 11, and it's starting to look like a repeat of August and September 2003 for Jack McKeon's club, when they put it all together and got hot at just the right time as the wild card.
They won a game with Ismael Valdez starting because the rest of the guys in that rotation we know about, and they're awfully tough.
Line into center field. Nomar Garcia Parra with 2 hits in his last 2 trips. And it'll bring up Moises Alou, who also has a 2-hit game. Nine Cub hits, all of them singles.
Nomar gets a slider that just hangs over the middle of the plate. He takes it back up the middle. That's the go-ahead and potential winning run. Moises with 2 hits in his last 2 at-bats.
Two hundred hours here in Montreal.
I'm just worried about how many hours Dorval is open.
Two more.
That's the airport.
Two more. Flies it out to Mirabel. Popped up. Always seems to happen on a getaway night in Montreal.
Well, the guy you always want to throw your getaway game would be Greg Maddux because he works real quickly. Tonight, Kerry Wood had overwhelming stuff. Unfortunately, he'll get a no decision in a game that he just dominated for eight innings. The bullpen has been very good. The Cub offense trying to plate at least one. They've got LaToya Hawkins in the game, so that's a man they want if they do get the lead. Vargas trying real hard to throw a wild pitch. He's thrown six of them this year. And that, by the way, leads the staff in that department. The advantage Moises has is that with Batista guarding the line and Gonzalez pretty much straight up, there's a lot of room on the left side to hit the ball through.
Fly ball center field. Playing deeply was Chavez, but it'll hang up nicely for him. And that's out number two. Back to first, Garcia Parra. That'll bring up Sammy Sosa. Sammy 3-for-12 in the series.
We've got Ramon Martinez in the on-deck circle. Remember, he came in when they took Ramirez down for a pinch runner. Ramirez with three base hits tonight.
High and away. One ball, no strikes.
Vargas, a big guy at 6'3", close to 230 pounds, out of the Dominican Republic.
Driven down the right field line, that one headed for the seats. Hockey fans here in Canada happy tonight. They beat Slovakia 5-1. Yeah. Hockey action this evening. One and two.
Bottom part of the order due up for the Expos.
Through the whole left side. Sammy Sosa, a base hit.
Well, that was the same defense that they employed for Moises with Batista toward the line. And so a lot of room on that left side. Sammy, with his second hit of the night, drove it through. Puts Garcia Parra in scoring position. And now everybody meeting at the mound. And what they want to do with Ramon Martinez.
10 Cubs singles.
One more would look good here.
It sure would.
I'm thinking you're going to send Garcia Parra regardless of where the ball is hit. Might as well put the pressure on the defense.
We've talked about Rivera and Wright. Remember, Schneider at the plate has yet to commit an error for the Expos this season. Ramon ready to go. And again, Vargas nearly uncorks a wild pitch.
He's tried, but Schneider won't let him so far.
One ball, no strikes. Scoreless game in the 11th.
Vargas was used as a starter part of this year. In fact, he started 13 times. This is a control problem that Vargas has had. One more of those, and it'll put it up to Mark Grudzielanek, who's in the on-deck circle.
Three balls, no strikes. And the bags are full of Cubs for Mr. Grudzielanek.
Here comes Randy St. Clair again.
Only the third walk issued by the Expos staff in tonight's game. It comes with two outs. It brings up Grudzielanek in a scoreless game.
Well, the way Vargas has thrown the baseball, you'd figure that one of these times he's going to throw it by Schneider, because he's stretched him out three different times in this inning. And now Ed Rapuano going out to break things up. No place to put Mark. The game on the bases for the Cubs. Now Kent Merker springs out of the dugout. You've got LaToya Hawkins in the game, the man you want if the Cubs get at least one. And LaToya stands to win it if Grudzielanek can come through.
Their bullpen gets busy as well.
It's Joey Eishen. Probably would be too little too late if he comes in the game.
Good speed aboard for the Cubs in the 11th. And there's the wild pitch. That's going to bring home the first run of the game. Nomar Garciaparra scores. Vargas flirted with that all inning long. It's 1-0.
That's how things work. You can only block so many in the dirt. And Garciaparra puts the Cubs on top, courtesy of Claudio Vargas. This one isn't close. Schneider has no chance at all.
So the scoreless misery ends at 24 and two-thirds here at Olympic Stadium. And now a chance to ensure it with a hit. And there it is, base hit. Sosa will score. Martinez around third. Here's the Chavez throw to the plate. It is in time. What a tag. A two-out base hit by Mark Grudzielanek, his 18th RBI. Martinez thrown out on a beautiful toss from Chavez. And to the bottom of the 11th we go. The Cubs have finally broken through. 2-0 is your score. The Cubs finally break through in the 11th.
Base hit right back up the middle. Andy Chavez makes a great throw. They cut down Ramon, but not before the Cubs wind up with a pair this inning. They lead by two. Ramon is gunned down. Great tag. But LaToya Hawkins stands to win it with three more outs. Andy Chavez with a throw. And Sammy acting as a coach. He still can't get him home. But the wild pitch, the base hit. The Cubs need three outs to go back to Chicago.
Here's Turris will start it off. He tripled last time up. How rare has it been for the Cubs in their last eight series in Montreal? Cubs have won one of them. They've got an excellent chance to win this series ending tonight. That's pumped right through there to even up the count. Fly ball left field, pretty well hit. Alou going back at the warning track, hauls it in. Ball was hit a long way by the little middle infielder. One out. Here's Carroll for Vargas. One can only wonder how differently the game might have turned had Carroll pinch hit in the eighth inning for Montreal with his tourist at third and one out.
Glad he didn't come in then. This guy doesn't strike out very much, just 14 times in 162 innings. But Pascucci did strike out. Kerry Wood with a blistering fastball. And as Tourist at third with only one out, the infield drawn in, and Kerry pitched his way out of it. A huge game to win for the Cubs. All of their pursuers at this point have won. San Diego, however, is trailing. Could pick up a game on them if St. Louis holds on.
The Giants host Colorado later. A Rocky team, though, that is 0-7 on their road trip and losers of eight consecutive. So very important for the Cubs to hold serve here tonight against a weekend Expo team. Back to the screen. Quickly, two strikes to Carroll. We will see the Expos Monday, September 6th, back at Wrigley Field. Two runs, 11 hits for the Cubs, all 11 hits singles. No runs, five hits, no errors. For Montreal, Cub pitching tonight, absolutely marvelous. Didn't mean to, but stays alive. Two and two. Wilkerson, a dangerous hitter, is waiting next.
It's real important to get Carroll out here because Wilkerson's a guy that can hit the ball out of the ballpark. You've got a two-run lead. This is a huge out.
Driven, fair ball into the corner. Carroll on his way to second base. He's going to stop there. Well, you're right, he is a tough man to whiff. And he puts bat on the baseball and doubles to right. And now you've got Wilkerson coming up with one out.
Takes this one right inside the line. You see him shortening his swing, trying to protect with two strikes. Winds up with a double.
Andy Chavez on deck now. Wilkerson with 26 home runs. Strike call. He thought it was high.
Joey Eichen throwing once again in the bullpen. You have to hope it's just for exercise. Buck sneaks ahead with a first ball fastball.
Nothing in one. Oh. base hit. Late break by Carroll. He's going to be stopped, and the Expos have him first and third.
Well, the Cubs get a break because that's when Sammy has to throw it to Derek Lee. He's fortunate that Wilkerson didn't read the throw. You've got to hit Derek Lee with this throw. And fortunately, Michael Barrett came up. They're not going to get too adventuresome. They've got runners at the corners. There's only one out for Andy Chavez and then Tony Batista. And the bullpen up and going, it's Kent Merker.
Chavez 0 for 4. 2-0 Cubs clinging here in the 11th inning. That ball whacked off the face mask of Michael Barrett.
He's only grounded into three double plays. Fastball, and Michael Barrett takes a little punishment. Hard hit ball. Second short to first. It will indeed be Andy.
One strike to Chavez. The Expos are hoping that that throw he made to Brian Schneider will play an important part in tonight's game.
Wilkerson is one of the stolen base threats. He's got 11. He's been caught four times.
One strike pitch. Two strikes now.
Tony Batista's hit 429 against the Troy Hawkins.
The 0-2 count. It's 1-2 now.
Tony Batista's in the on deck circle.
He is 0 for 4 on the night.
We've got Lester and Merker throwing in the pen.
One ball, two strikes. Cubs by two. Poke toward third base. Slow developing play, and that's all we can get. A forced play at second drives home Carroll. It's now a 2-1 game. Runner at first, two outs, and Batista coming up.
RBI number 28 for Chavez. Won't mean anything if you can get by Batista. No chance for two. But you have to keep your eye on Andy Chavez. This guy's their premier base stealer. He's got 23 of them.
He's been caught just five times, and he's been successful. Nine of the last 10 he's attempted to steal. Pretty good lead. Foot on the edge of the carpet. Not going. Batista breaks his bat, flares it into center field. Patterson coming on. He's there, and the Cubs have won. Two out of three in Montreal. 2-1 the final score. We're heading back to Chicago. Very happy indeed, Steve. The Cubs will at least share the top spot in the wild card another day.
Long way to go, but the Cubs now 4-2 in extra inning games on the road. That's a very impressive number. LaToya Hawkins gets the win, well earned. The Cubs score just enough. They take it a long way, but win 2-1. And a very happy trip home. A very happy Cub team.
Hawkins goes to 4-4 on the year. Vargas, the loser, now 5-5 for Montreal. It all started with great starting double-digit strikeouts.
And he's our Hyundai player of the game, as well-deserved as that was. The Cubs had a little offense at the end, and Dave Kaplan is ready to take it away.
All right, thank you, guys. Coming up on the Cubs post-game show, we'll check in live, go back, talk to Chip Stoney and Dave Otto. Plus, with Hurricane Francis bearing down on South Florida, what does that do to the Cubs' travel plans for their next game Friday at Florida? We'll update the standings in the National League wildcard chase. Don't go anywhere. Big win tonight.
The Illinois Lottery. Have a ball with the Illinois Lottery during their 30th anniversary celebration. by Pepsi. It's the cola. And by Southwest Airlines. Over 2,800 daily nonstops to 60 destinations all across the country.
There's nothing like being on the inside, and we'll take you there with the WB Insider. From returning favorites Smallville to new WB shows The Mountain and more, watch the WB Insider tonight at 7 on WGN, Chicago's WB.
It's almost here. The One Tree Hill season premiere is September 21st. But Tuesday, go behind the scenes and get a new season update from Hillary Burton, One Tree Hill.
Tuesday night at 11:30 on WGN.
Four, and another walk by Tree 11 who forces Skipper to make